YouTube. All right, guys, if you've been following along, we took this thing out on the dunes, checked it out, got a first rip around with the paddles on and everything. Hopefully you guys have seen that video before. We ended up having to cut the run short because we snapped the axle, which I knew we were gonna do. It was already electricians taped together because of the power that this thing had with the paddles on it already was separating out the yoke. So I knew it was gonna happen. Tried to extend the life a little bit so we could go get the trip at the coast, but it just finally just snapped it off in the sand. But that's okay, because I had already ordered the MIPs. They were already coming in the mail. They just hadn't got here yet. So tonight, that's what we're working on. I got the battery extender so that it can go from a 2-cell to a 3-cell, because right now, when we remove the original ESC mount up here, there's nothing to hold the back side of your battery, and then this front part, which was just a bar, that bar couldn't set up high enough to get a 3-cell under it. So literally I've just been running a rubber band, and that's worked so far. But went ahead and got the right pieces in. If you're looking for the expansion for your battery, for the Bandit, Rustler, Slash, I believe, Slash uses the different setup, but that's the part number anyway. We'll be putting that on today too. I put the actual standoff that holds the original ESC in my Stampede, so I don't have it. So I'm hoping that we can just use this with the extension posts that it give. And this is one of the original pieces from the Stampede, so they're kind of like playing swaparoo. So hopefully with the extended posts up, we can use this to secure the back, and then the extended posts on the front to secure this original tie bar in the front, and some padding in the middle of it. So we'll check it out. Let me go ahead and get started with we're gonna do the battery part first, and then we'll do the axles next. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is, like I said, instead of the ECU plate, we're gonna use this. We're gonna use two of the holes and two of these spacers. We're not gonna use all four like it shows in the instructions, because we're not using the original bracket like it wants us to. Because, well, nothing is standard, right? We can't do anything the way the instructions say to. That just wouldn't be right. It just wouldn't feel right. And amazingly enough, these are actually hex head screws from Traxxas. That's pretty crazy. So, let me get the right head on my driver here. We'll get the first one put in and kind of give you an idea of how the back is going to be set up. If you had the original ECU plate and you wanted to run it, then it would be very simple. Unbolt it, put the spacers in, bolt it back up. It would be in the same location, the same setup. But we're not doing it that way. We never do it the way the instructions say. I want to be careful here because I want to get underneath of my motor wires to get all this stuff in there and started. I don't want them to get pinched in the middle of all of it. But of course, all of it is extremely hard to get to and see. So I want to fix it up and then we'll be right back. All right, so now you guys can see how it's set up. Just got the two spacers in the back. A little brace of pieces that's going to go over top of the battery. Going to prevent the battery from flying straight out. So this will be the hold down in the back. I'll end up cleaning off this back a little bit more. And then this will be where this will set in there. I'll probably put some kind of Gorilla Glue, just like I did here around the ECU. Because this actually ECU, even though I used that 3MW side double-sided tape, and I cleaned the chassis and everything with alcohol before I put it on there, it didn't actually stick. It ended up coming off just playing around in the yard. I was pretty unimpressed with that. So I just took some Gorilla Glue and smashed it on there, and it ain't going nowhere anytime soon now. So now we'll go ahead and pull these front posts up, and it's got extended posts that come with the kit. So we'll go ahead and pull these and slap in the extended ones. All right, front post extenders on there. So we went through a lot of effort to do this. So what exactly was it we were doing? So this is a 2-cell. Just a regular old 2-cell Gen's Ace. So this one would have fit in here before with the small posts. So if we would have had these small posts in here still, We could have set this tie bar across it, and it would have fit just fine. Well, we can still use those original spots, or the original height, because it has holes in these extended pins to hold the 2S. But when we're ready to go crazy and we want to throw a 3S in here, this is a 3S Gen's Ace, same battery, just a little bigger. When you throw that in, your tie bar is way, way higher than it is with a 2-cell. So you have to have the extension to be able to run a bigger battery, and that's exactly what this kit does. So now when you plug it up, you'll be set to be able to run a 3S without having huge slop, without having the battery fall out, and literally because it's held in the back and held in the front. Now the battery literally can't come out of the car. So now we're good to go. All of the batteries coming unplugged and coming unhooked and everything, that's all over now. And also with this, I don't think many people talk about it, and it's not a big deal unless you're more of a racer type person. But where you put the battery matters. If you mount the battery further forward in your car, you'll have more nose weight, more front end weight, and less rear traction. So putting this foam in the back spaces it and pushes the battery forward. If you take the spacer out and put it here at the front, then what you're doing is you're spacing your battery back and allowing it to slide back and get as much weight and traction to the back of the car as you can. Now, I don't really care. I'm not a racer. This thing's not going to be weight balanced by its battery. The battery is more just convenience and bash proof and needs to be able to hold this battery in while I'm doing whatever crazy stuff I want to do. So for me, the balance doesn't really matter. If you're really interested in the balance, trying to keep your balance perfect and all that, then you use your battery tray to locate your weight. So all right, that part is done. So now I'm going to go ahead and start on the axle holes. Okay. So for the rear axles, if you've done any of the MIP heavy duty axles, this is going to be the exact same thing. These ones I actually got are for the slash. And the reason I did that is because these A-arms are for the slash. Like the extended width of this, if I would have ordered Bandit ones, they wouldn't really fit. Because the Bandit's has got a narrower arm. It looks like the Rustler, Slash, Stampede, a lot of them have the same length. But you'll notice that Bandit's not listed there. So don't screw up and buy ones that are for the Bandit, because if you widen your A-arms at all, go with a wider stance, then you can't not use those shorter ones. So just one of those things to watch out for. So we're going to have to tear off I'm going to undo the top ones, but we're going to tear off all the hubs, the top tie links for the camber. We can flop the axles over. Pull these stock ones out, and then we'll start assembling these with Loctite. Loctite on every single part of this. Sometimes these come with Loctite, sometimes they don't. I don't actually see Loctite in this package. Okay, there it is. Liquid thread is what they're calling what they give you. I don't know. I'm going to use my Loctite. Because I've had these come loose, and that's the only pain with these. These are tough as nails. I don't think you're going to snap them. I've never snapped them on my four-wheel drive slash and all that. Brushless power, never snapped one, never had a problem. But I have had the screws come out, loosen and lose pins. And those little tiny set screws and little pins and stuff in there. Let's see if it'll focus. They're annoying and aggravating. So I would go with the best Loctite you got. So let me go ahead and get this thing ripped apart. Let's see if I can get you guys some good video of this. Good look at this. So this is the aluminum hex from STRC that I put on. As you can see, it's deforming. Like the actual aluminum is being pushed out and around where that drive pin goes, and it's deforming the hex. Hopefully you guys are seeing that good. I'm amazed. I thought that they were tougher than this, I didn't think the Bandit had quite the power to be bending aluminum hexes, but it is. I mean, I know the Bandit's powerful and it's got a lot of traction with those paddle tires, but holy moly, I didn't think that we'd actually be deforming the aluminum hexes. The pin looks fine. I don't see anything wrong with the pin. It's not out of shape or anything. So you can tell that the pin is a lot tougher than this aluminum is. Apparently they're using a lot weaker aluminum than they used to. My Slash has got STRC hexes all the way around, and I've never seen them deform before. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's because I haven't taken mine off in a long time. Maybe they are deformed underneath. But anyway, I just wanted to show you guys that while I was taking them off, that, I don't know, this motor is the cheapest brushless motor I could buy, but I tell you what, it's got some stank to it. It's breaking axles and bending aluminum and slinging sand like crazy. I am very highly impressed for the money that I spent on this Onyx motor from Horizon Hobby. $80. I'm extremely impressed. So I can't believe that it does what it does. Now, it probably won't do it forever. It'll probably wear out faster. It may not have enough power to run a four-wheel drive vehicle with a lot more rotating mass and two axles and all that. But for a two-wheel drive, holy moly, it's got a lot of power. All right, now next I'll yank these stock axles out. And I know we kind of touched upon this already when we were going through our axle issues to start off with, but these are an upgraded part. This is a Traxxas hardened output yoke. You'd think that'd be really good, right? The original is plastic. These ones are all metal. Be great. Oh, what? You're telling me that the pin that's supposed to be set in steel is broke loose? That's gonna really hold onto a driveline great, isn't it? I would not waste your money on these. I wouldn't waste 10 cents on these. I am really upset that I bought them. I didn't see any bad reviews or negative reviews by anybody about these before I bought them. So I bought them, and yeah, what a waste. Those things are terrible. Terrible design if the center pin can just start going back and forth. And that is what starts to cause the wear on these things. If both of these pins, or if those pins aren't equally on each side of the yoke, or in one side more than the other, one side slips out, then it just chews them. I'm sure that's what happened to this one. Because that's what was happening when we put the electrician's tape on. You can see this one worn a lot, but see how it's sticking out that side? Get my hand behind here. So you can see how the pin is sticking out this side, but it's not sticking out that side. And it's actually recessed back in there. Yes, there's sand all over it, but that pin should be equal on each side. It's equal in the yoke, but what garbage. Look at that sand, boy. You can tell how that sand will get into joints and stuff and just wear them. That's why when you go to the dunes and you're playing sand, clean it all. This shouldn't have had wet lube, but I noticed as I was pulling these apart that the actual tranny is losing its grease out the outputs. So because there's no real seal on those outputs, it's just the bearings, it's actually losing some of its grease. So not much you can do about that, but FYI. So alright, I'm going to go ahead and take some time and get a toothbrush in here, clean all the sand out of the output drives, try and get as much of the grease and stuff as I can out of around them too, and then we'll go ahead and bust open this new package and start putting it together. So this is one of the things I love about the MIP stuff. So with the axles, I bought output drives separate. They didn't come with these Jado axles. And with these, they don't come with the hex. And they don't come with the drive pin. So you have to use your stock drive pin, buy SRTRC hexes, and kind of piece together an axle. So that you have an axle you can put in your rig. Yeah, this one's a little different because I had to widen the width or whatever. But when you buy it from MIP, it's everything. It's hex, wheel nut, all your spacers and stuff to go in between your bearings, the axle, the drive flange, all this stuff is included. So here's the new hexes that we'll be using. All the hardware that goes in between it. We'll reuse the bearings. They're still good. We just put them in when we put in the other extended axles. And so now we're just going to be assembling this stuff. And I've actually even changed my mind. This is a blue Loctite. I'm going to go ahead and grab my red Loctite. I don't ever want to have these come apart. I don't ever want to have to mess with them again. And if I just use red Loctite right off the bat, then I know I won't have to mess with them. So I'm going to go grab my red Loctite real quick. All right. I know what I do would drive some people crazy because I just basically open up all the nuts and bolts, just throw them down in a pile and start grabbing them. But that's just the way I roll. So That's what we're going to do. See if we can slap these suckers together. There we go. Two set screws, one on each side. That one doesn't feel like it's threading right. Maybe that's not the right one. There we go. It wasn't the right one. So the correct ones have this little nipple on them. Those little nipples will be what holds against your output shaft. So basically I'll get all this stuff kind of built, mocked together, and then I'll pull it apart, put Loctite, and then we'll do the final tighten down on everything. So we're going to take one of these barrels, and now that little set screw that I had is the part that goes into this barrel. So on one end of this barrel, it's threaded, and one end it's not. So then this barrel is going to set in between here. And then we're going to put the drive pin through here and line it all up, all at one time. So it's going to go through the outer cup, through the inner cup, through that barrel that we put in there, and then we'll be able to tighten the hex right here. Now the trick to this is, and if you look closely as I was pushing this together, you'll see that this pin has a flat spot on it. See that flat spot right there? So that flat spot you want to be turned to match up with your lock nut, your jam nut that you got. So we're going to try and push it in and line it up with that. Then everything's all lined up and ready to go. Going to back this out, slap some Loctite on it. Red Loctite. Still holding it all in place. And you can kind of move it all as you're doing it. Rotate it around a little bit so that drive pin will for sure find the flat. See, now I can see I'm holding on to just that drive pin and it's moving the whole output. That means it's in that flat spot. It's not rotating anymore. So I'll go ahead and give her the full tighten. Wipe off what little tiny excess Loctite, that way it's not getting into something else. And there we go. First joint is done. So that basically completes the first part of it. So the second part is very similar, except you're going to use the spline part of the axle and your actual drive shaft that's going to stick out that you're going to attach your wheels to. But it's the same thing. I'm going to take one of these barrels. That barrel is going to have a threaded insert. And you're going to take a drive pin and you're going to line it all up. You're going to line up the cup, the drive pin, try and line up that flat that's on the pin, just like we talked about on the other one. Try and line it up at the same time if you can, just save yourself one extra step of trying to get it in the right orientation. And then you can kind of hold it all together, pull back out your set pin, little red Loctite. And if you look down in it, it's kind of hard to see, but if you look down inside the hole, You can actually see whether you're on the flat spot or not. Doesn't look like I'm going to be able to get enough light for you guys to see it. But you can see that flat spot on the drive pin that goes through. So you can kind of look in there and make sure that you got it good and flat before you put in this screw. So that way when you tighten it in, you'll know. Now you can still use that same trick that I was doing before. Hold on to the pin. See how the pin is holding it up? So you can still use that trick to know, but you can also visually check just by looking down in there. Alright. So there's our pretty much completed axle. So the only other thing we have to do is on this, there's a spacer they want you to put between the bearings. So on the stock bearing setup, it just has a gap. Pretty much. There's a plastic piece between the bearings, and you can see that plastic lip there. Let me see if I can get this to point at. So there's a plastic lip. So your bearing actually sets clear out here, but then there's this plastic lip and then the other bearing. What they want to do is they want to try and transfer some of that load to go through the bearings. So they want you to include this spacer to go in there, and it actually sets inside of that plastic piece that's smaller. So I'm just going to put it on the end of this tool and have it help me put it in there. Maybe. Might have to use it on the end of my wrench. Because they actually want it to set up in that smaller portion. There we go. So there. Now basically what it does is instead of the two bearings being able to be pinched together when you tighten everything, before, without that spacer in there, these bearings would try and suck into that plastic because they'd be getting pinched together. But now that spacer is going to touch the inside of this bearing to that spacer to the inside of the other bearing and allow you to tighten up the nut and bolt to it to hold everything captured without having any pressure into that plastic or without the bearing being weird, being pulled in a strange way. Move this back a tiny bit. Alright, so I'm going to go ahead and put this on the output shaft. I'm going to go ahead and put the Loctite on it as I do it. I'm just going to go ahead and pull out both of them. Set one down here for now and Loctite the first one. And this is kind of the same way as that shaft. There's a flat spot on two sides of your output shaft on your transmission. Get you guys tipped up a little bit. So there's two flat spots on each side of this transmission output. Well, that's the same thing. You want to hit it where these are going on those flat spots. So if you can visually see where the transmission's at and get a flat spot lined up to where you know you're going to be putting the screw in right off the bat, you'll be a step ahead. So rotate it however you need to so that it's in the alignment you need. Start my screw in. Push this up on there. Might have to tip it a little bit. Because the pin that was on here originally was a little tiny hex head. You know, something like this. We're replacing it with a hex head. You know, it's this size. I don't know what this is. A 1.5. 2 millimeter hex? I'm not sure. It's much larger than that original one was, I can tell you that much. So I'm just making sure now that I'm hitting the flat spot and that I'm actually getting a chance to rotate this in, and it's going in to contact the output. So when you have it installed correctly, it should be looking like that. Kind of hard to see in there. I know it's dark. See if I can. So you see how it's almost flush with the cup? That's the way it needs to be. If it's still sticking out more, you're not hitting the flat on the output. So you need to make sure you rotate it correctly. So I'm going to go ahead and cut here and get these thrown on, or one side thrown on, and we'll show you. All right, guys. So there's the first one clear done. Still got to attach the camber link to it, but fully set up and ready to go. Fully Loctited. Got the new hex pin on there. It's mounted onto the flat. All the spacers and stuff, make sure you follow the instructions for all the little bits and pieces they want you to put in what little bit and piece in place. And now we're good to go. This side is done. I can go ahead and put the paddle tire back on after I steal the paddle tire back off my daughter's slash. Because we went ahead and swapped over, put them on the slash just for fun. Because this thing had stopped running, the axle had broke, so... To keep having more fun, we went ahead and switched it over. But I'll steal those paddles back and we'll put them back on this. And from this point on, red Loctite used, MIP. We'll never have to worry about axles again. We might screw up the bearings in the tranny. We might screw up the spur. We might do all kinds of stuff. But I'm not going to have no problem with axles anymore. All right. There we go, ladies and gents. All done up, all fixed up. A couple MIP stickers to now slap on the ride, show that we're riding those MIPs, and a little buy note. So I didn't really show any of it on camera, but every time I pull out one of the bearings anywhere on a car, I always just hold them like this and just roll it real quick. Well, I know you guys can't hear it because it's not really audible, but this bearing is toast. You can literally feel it. That's whatever, four batteries, five batteries that this bearing went from brand new to shot. So when you're doing this kind of stuff, replacing parts or whatever, always check and feel your bearings. Check them out. I already replaced this one, but I've got multiple different bearing kits for everything. Here's a whole nother brand new, haven't even popped this one open, but bearing kit ready to go, because bearings are wear items. They're just like brakes on a car. They wear out. They're going to go bad. This one probably went bad because it's the outside bearing on these big paddles. And with that much weight whipping around, it went bad really quick. And the sand, of course, but I did not expect it to go bad that quickly. We're set to go now. Got the batteries in there, all tied down the way it's supposed to now. Oh man, this thing is set now. I think the only thing left to do on this thing is I may get the Fast Lane Machine FLM bumper, this front bulkhead, and possibly the top plate in aluminum. Just to add functional weight to the front. I'm not going to be doing A-arms, those are my brake points. For the front, don't want to do the actual chassis because that adds weight to everything. I don't want to add just weight. I just want weight for the front. So the front bumper, front bulkhead, and maybe the front top plate just to add some more weight up here. And then if that still doesn't provide me the weight that I want to try and hill climb and stuff, then I'll just start stacking lead weights right here in the front of it until it has enough weight in the front where it'll hill climb good. Right now with the wheelie bar and everything, it's working out good. The hot racing wheelie bar worked real good in the sand. Keeps it from going over. You can ride a wheelie all day. So I like that. But it's still, when you're trying to hill climb, it just always wants to be wheels off the ground. So for the hill climbs on the dunes and stuff, I'd like to have just a little bit more front weight. Just to hold that front end down just a tiny bit more. But it's kind of a balancing act, right? Guy wants wheelies, wants it to stand up good and wheelie good. But at the same time, want it to go up the hills good. So it's one of those things. I think that just a slight bit of weight by adding those aluminum parts up front will get us what I want without having to go and compromise all of the wheelies, because I really do like this thing and how fast it wheelies. And so that's it for this tonight, guys. I hope you guys enjoyed, and hope you guys have enjoyed seeing this Bandit become so much more than a Bandit. And we'll catch you next time.